This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your monthly guest host, Kelly Chase. Whitley will be back in the captain's chair next week. Today, I have a great guest for you, researcher and podcast host, James Iandoli. Many of you are likely already familiar with James from his incredible podcast, Engaging the Phenomenon, or from his work in co-hosting the Inquiry into Anomalous Experience and the Phenomenon conference series. James is a skilled and thoughtful researcher who has a particular interest in contact work, which we'll talk about more in this episode. And I also think he's one of the best interviewers in the space. If you haven't checked out his podcast, I hope that you will. His recent interviews with Jim Semivan, Peter Lavenda, and Keith Thompson were all standouts. You'll also be able to catch James in the upcoming docuseries that I'm writing and executive producing called The Beyond, UFOs and a New Reality, and that'll be premiering later this fall. All right, let's get into it. Here's my conversation with my friend, James Iandoli. Well, hi, James. Welcome to Dreamland. It's so great to have you here.
Hey, thank you for having me on, Kelly. It's great to be talking to you again.
Yeah, absolutely. I can't believe we haven't done this on like one of our shows yet after I feel like all our conversations have been in person, which is lovely. But I'm so excited. I've been meaning to have you on for a while, and there's so much I want to talk to you about. So I just want to dive right into it. So to get us started, I'd love to hear, you're somebody who, you know, has been in this field for quite some time, definitely not somebody who like just got here in 2017. So could you maybe talk a little bit, however much you're comfortable with, about kind of what brought you into this field, how you find yourself, you know, in this world of ufology?
Yeah, wow. that is a good question. So, you know, I got involved in the subject of UFOs and even you can say anomalous experiences very early on, you know, just due to experiences that I had. But I also like to consider myself a researcher, so, but I'm gonna qualify all that. So, you know, from a very young age, like, you know, 5, 6, 7, I was having anomalous experiences of a variety, right? I had out-of-body experiences where I would just, you know, be on the verge of sleep, and then all of a sudden, while I'm still conscious, I see myself kind of floating out of my body, and then, you know, I look down, and I'm looking at myself, and I'm like, holy crap, and then boom, you know, I'm back in my body. So when I would have experiences like that, they always stood out to me. I never, you know, as a child, you never... I mean, I don't think you even have the rationale at that point at like 5 or 6 to be like, oh, was that real or not? Like, of course it was real because you experienced it, right? So that, I had that. And then a kind of like the most jarring was that I was having entity encounters with, you know, you can call them kind of like shadow beings, but it, you know, it was highly telepathic. And I'm, you know, like it wasn't just like, oh, I saw some kind of weird shadow thing. First thing before anything was that I sensed the presence. And as I'm sensing the presence, I'm kind of looking over and I see a kind of shadow type entity that has like a very soft glow to it. And the first thing that I heard was he can see us. And that really freaked me out because I saw the one initially, and then there were 3 altogether, and they were moving and like almost collapsed into an orb. And then at that point, I'm covering myself in blankets, freaking out. And I hear almost kind of like gibberish, right? But I can like sense the communication behind it. It was like, you ever saw that movie, The Knowing with Nicolas Cage? Like whoever designed that, I don't think that was just like a random thing they just made up, because it's so on point. The whisper people and that kind of whispering thing is like, what, that's what I heard audibly. Like there was an audible sound to it, but, you know, but there was a, telepathic component, which was like, you know, I was trying to shut it out, right? Like panicking basically. And this happened, you know, over a half dozen times, but, you know, periodically. It wasn't like every night. It would happen spontaneously, as far as I'm concerned. There's nothing I did that initiated it. It was just random, and you know, so to speak, whatever is random. So, you know, because of experiences like the out-of-body experiences, those kind of entity experiences, and at the time, there was no connection for me to UFOs for those entities. I was thinking, oh my God, it's like a ghost or spirit, or I don't know. I still don't know what it is, but it wasn't until many years after that I had even considered that it was associated with the UFO phenomenon. After I began doing research, even at a very young age, and you know, I live in the Hudson Valley area, right? So the Hudson Valley UFO wave happened around the time I was born. So the area kind of had this kind of presence or, you know, vibe to it, I guess you can say. And, you know, there were several thousand people here who had sightings and experiences that were, you know, some of which were outlined in a book by Dr. J. Allen Hynek's last book, which was co-authored with a gentleman named Philip Imbrogno, called Night Siege, the Hudson Valley UFO Wave. And, you know, I remember I got my hands on that book even in, you know, I must have been like 12 or 13 or so, but because I had those experiences, among others, I was always interested in these kind of topics, from, you know, whether it be psychic phenomena or, you know, out of body experiences and even UFOs. And I had a number of UFO sightings when I was younger as well, but they were not profound in the sense where it was like, wow, I said that there was like a metal disc or anything like that involved, which ended up happening in 2007. But, you know, I had seen objects in the sky, and I even took one of those old, you know, those like cameras you get at CVS or one of those stores. And like, I would go out at night trying to take pictures of them. And I'd go out on my roof and do it, or I'd go walk out in the neighborhood at night and trying to take pictures of these like orb-like objects in the sky, which I never actually developed. I was just like in my own mind, it was my version of trying to capture something. But yeah, again, with all that said, I was always interested in the subject and all like the anomalous kind of topics from a very young age. And so from a young age, I had already been, you know, reading books. And then of course I had the kind of like one at that point in the 90s, there was like the one-off, Unsolved Mysteries and those kind of shows where it'd be like 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. in the morning and they're playing some kind of late night UFO program. So I had that kind of background. And then it wasn't until about 2007 when I had some really kind of in-your-face UFO encounters, which brought the UFO topic front and center for me.
That's so interesting. I love that you brought up the movie Knowing. I only recently watched it and I was surprised because I love Nicolas Cage and I love kind of like disaster movies. And I was like, how have I never seen this? And then once I saw it, I was like, oh, this is why I've never seen it, because it was actually whoever wrote that, like, knew what they were talking about. Like, there is a lot of stuff in there, I think, for people who are familiar with this field that are like, oh, somebody who knew their stuff wrote this movie for sure.
Yeah.
It's really interesting. What was it like for you? Because I want to hear about those other experiences, but what was it like for you in your younger years, you know, having these experiences that were kind of so different and outside of the box? Did you have people in your life that you were able to talk to about that stuff? Or was that something you just kind of kept to yourself? What was that like?
So, I'd mentioned it to my friends. And some of my friends were interested in, maybe I would say friends in the EST kind of stuff. Not so much UFOs, but I never considered it strange at that point because it happened to me so young. So I never felt like embarrassed to talk about it. Except maybe the entity thing, because that it was scary, pretty much frightening. And I want to say it was not frightening in the sense that I felt threatened or than I was threatened. The idea itself of some kind of entity in my room was really scary, but I was never harmed or threatened or anything by any kind of entity. It was just, maybe you can say ontological shock or like, what the hell is going on? Just at the same as if you were in your backyard and you see glowing eyes and it's some animal and you don't know what it is, you might be like, oh my God, what is that kind of thing? Hopefully not a bear or something, but that kind of, the idea of something unknown in your presence can be scary.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I can't even imagine. I mean, I'm an adult and I feel like that would freak me out. So totally understandable. So you mentioned you had some experiences kind of like in like sort of the late aughts. You want to talk about those a little? Those seem to be a little more impactful in terms of changing the kind of trajectory of things for you.
Yeah. So those experiences, I mean, when I was younger, like those experiences were certainly impressionable, but I was very young. So when this happened, it was in 2007. So at that point, I'm 20 years old. And they were kind of really in your face and undeniable and most certainly tied to UFOs. And there was a lot of high strangeness and it all seemed to be tethered together through this weird, I'm going to explain some of it, keep in mind, like in some weird sense, after years of contemplating all this, it almost seems like some of the future events had instigated the events in the past, if that makes any sense. There's this really weird dynamic to it that it still really kind of baffles me. But the series of events started in the early summer. Yeah, it was early summer of 2007. And the first event of all this was that I was working an overnight shift and I was at work and kind of just minding my business and going through my regular routine. And before I had left work, one of my coworkers, who's like a super kind of agnostic dude, kind of very basic as far as conversation, like we would talk about like, hey, how's your family kind of thing, that, very basic conversation. Nothing kind of like strange. And out of nowhere, he said to me, hey, did you hear about the UFOs in Mexico? And I was thinking to myself, like, why is he asking me this, right? Because I had an interest at the time, but he certainly didn't know about it. And it was out of place for him to talk about something so weird out of nowhere. And I said, no, because I didn't hear about any kind of UFO sightings in Mexico at that point. In the recent time, there's nothing in the media that I could recall. So I just kind of brushed off and was like, okay, whatever, it's time for me to leave and go home. I'm just going to go home and go to sleep. So I went home, I went to sleep, and while I'm dreaming, I go to sleep. I have a dream that there's like, I'm like, I guess you could say I went to sleep. And then all of a sudden I'm in this dream. And there was this, in the dream, I'm driving in my old neighborhood where I used to take pictures in the sky and that kind of thing. I had moved at that point. So I was driving in that old neighborhood at night, and right above my car, maybe like 15, 20 feet above the car and maybe like 10 feet in front of me, there was just this electrical orange UFO in the dream. And it was like a plasma electric object. And it was like, you could hear kind of like a buzzing from it. And I could feel shocks in my body in this dream. And all, and in the dream, I'm just like so reactionary. I'm just like trying to get away from it. I don't know why. I'm not thinking about why. I'm just like trying to drive away as fast as I can. And I this goes on for maybe like 2 minutes of me trying to evade this object. And I can't get away. And eventually I just snap out of it and I wake up. So when I wake up, it's the daytime. I had worked the overnight. So it's got to be like between 3 and 4 in the afternoon. I wake up and I'm like, just kind of like coming to, like, what the heck is, you know, I wasn't like, when I woke up the first few seconds, I recalled the dream, but I was like, okay. So after maybe a minute or so, a family member had come in to the room or into the house. And, you know, I was just waking up and stuff. So they said to me, hey, did you hear about the UFOs in Mexico? So then at that point, I knew something was like completely off, right? It just, the whole thing, get that, when they said that, then I'm thinking, I'm recalling the morning and then the dream, and I'm like, you know, kind of like, screw this. This is like too weird right now, right? So I leave my house, and I was going to go to this Chinese place down the street and just get Chinese food and like gather my thoughts basically. So I get into my car and I started driving. And, you know, again, this is early summer. It's a clear sky, you know, very sunny, open blue sky. And within a few hundred feet of driving, I see this orange fireball, like, right in the center of the sky. And I'm looking at it, and the first thing I think is like, holy crap, that's an effing UFO. And the second that I thought that, it began to move. And I'm just like freaking out, but it was like in a good way. I wasn't like panicking. I was like, holy crap. Like, I knew that I'm looking at something like extraordinary. And, you know, it was just gliding across, and it was smaller than the size of a dime. And I mean, my perspective of it was that it was kind of a bigger object that was maybe 1500 feet to 3000 feet in the sky. It didn't feel like it didn't feel like it was way in the atmosphere. It did not look that way. It looked like it was lower than that. And again, there was a living quality to it. I say a fireball because it wasn't just like a solid ball of light. It was like living light, right? If I could even say that, that's kind of what it looked like. It was like, it had like a lava lamp type quality to it, but it was contained and brighter. But anyway, so it was gliding away, and it eventually just got out of sight where I couldn't follow with my car anymore. So I was trying to chase it. And, you know, after that, the kind of like hype of trying to chase this object, everything kind of dawned on me at that point, as far as the entire sequence of events, because I mean, seeing the UFO or UAP in broad daylight was incredible and amazing. And, you know, again, I was excited and trying to chase it. But the thing that really hit me the hardest was like the whole sequence of events. Like, how does that happen? Right. Like, the idea of like, wow, there's even like at that point, like, okay, maybe my mindset at that point was more like, oh, these must be extraterrestrials or something. That's what subconsciously, and we you know, at least back then for me, I'm taking it for granted from watching this UFO programming on TV that UFOs must be out. So I didn't need, you know, I'm not even like second guessing that at that point when I'm 20 years old. Like, it's just sometimes we don't even are not even aware that we were making that assumption, right? But so the idea of some entity and some kind of fireball craft or whatever it is, like that didn't seem like so strange or like outlandish to me. Like, okay, like I could rationalize that, right? There's some entities and some kind of weird object and they're moving. But I could not wrap my head around how is it possible that that event occurred that was tied into all these other events that occurred, you know, in the synchronicity. I still can't make sense of that, right? So the sighting or the encounter was incredible, but what is more profound is the whole sequence of events, right? To consider how that is possible is even more amazing than the idea of, wow, we're being visited by some intelligence. That's speaking more to like the nature of reality of how could that even occur? So, you know, that was the first event, believe it or not, of a whole sequence of events that were connected.
We'll be right back after this quick break. Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
So that event occurred at probably the very beginning of the summer. And within a month and a half to 2 months after that, I was working these overnight, and I was working like a lot of times, 7 days a week. And I ended up getting into a car accident in that same exact area, which I didn't even, some of these details, I didn't even consider tying them that they were part of one thing until after the whole thing. Because you're like in the moment and all these things are happening and kind of blowing your mind already. So I didn't even consider that this at the time that, wow, this was in the same place. But in the same, like in the same exact place, I had gotten into a car accident. And this, it was in daylight. It was in the morning. I had stayed up from an overnight and I was like, oh, I'm going to go somewhere. And I got into this car accident. And when the accident occurred, the first thing that was in my conscious recollection was this this light beam was directly in front of me. I was in some kind of altered reality. I can say that. I didn't see like my surroundings that were immediate to my physical body. I was maybe in something you can call it like another realm or something. I don't know. But there was this light entity in front of me that had a little bit of a weird shaped head, and it had a torso and arms, and the body tapered down, and I didn't see any kind of like feet or legs. It's almost like if you would envision like a spirit entity. That's what this entity looked like. And there weren't too many like details on the face or the body or so much other than the outline and the light that was emanating from it. It was like a whitish blue light entity. And for some reason, I could not, it was as if this entity was literally one with me. There felt like there was no distinction between us, lit in a literal sense. And I'm not like religious. I went to CCD and stuff because I had to, that kind of thing. But I was not like a religious person per se. I was kind of going through the motions and like that kind of thing. But when this thing happened, when I saw this entity and I felt that we were literally one in some way, I heard this like a crystalline angelic orchestra. It was like heavenly. That's the only kind of way I can describe it. That you could not make or hear those sounds in this physical plane kind of thing. And while that's going on, I heard a voice say, yeah, God is all there is, ever was, and ever will be. And then with that, it's like my consciousness reset. And all of a sudden, I'm above the accident looking down on it. And I can see the car and ambulance and people around the car and looking down on everything, like kind of like an out-of-body experience. And just for clarity, I was never near death during this experience. I had probably a concussion, so I call it a trauma-induced out-of-body experience. But it simulated like a near-death experience. Because when I was above the car, I was thinking, so this is it, huh? Like I thought I was dead, and I'm looking down at the accident, and that must be it. And I was like absolutely tranquil. I was so cool with it. I did not have one concern, one regret. It was just like the way it is, and it felt great, kind of thing. Like there was a sense of equanimity. Like through and through, there was not one like question or concern or care. It was just so totally cool. Yeah. And so, I was talking before that I didn't put pieces together until in some cases years later, that I did, I went out that from where I was above this, the accident looking down, that vantage point was the exact spot where I saw the UFO.
Wow.
Like if I was in the UFO and looking down at the accident, that's exactly where it was, like literally. And I didn't even recognize that until I was explaining the experience to one person a number of years ago. And I was like, holy shit, that's the same exact spot. And that vantage point is the point where I would have been looking. So that was the whole thing. But anyways, after I was looking down at the accident, my body and the whole thing, or the scene of the you know, ambulance and the car, and that lasted for a few moments. And there was this weird, sense of perceiving time. Like the past, present, and the future kind of like one thing. Like, and again, like literally like a, again, like 360 kind of view, but not of just reality, but of time itself, of everything. And it was incredible. Even at that point, I was conscious the whole time I'm experiencing all this, but not reactive. There was this really calm and tranquil sense to everything, and it was like I was perceiving the world as no reactions, like non-reactionary. If I can try to make sense of that. So after a few moments of all this, it's hard to describe the sequence of events and how they happened. And it's difficult because there was this sense that it was all happening at one time. So it is hard for me to describe, no matter how many times I talk about the experience. It's still hard for me to wrap my head around it all and try to communicate it in the way exactly as it occurred, because it's transcendental in that nature.
Right.
It's really difficult to describe in words and to capture like the essence of everything. So I end up snapping back to my body, and I'm like, holy crap, I'm alive. And I was shocked. I was grateful. I was like, wow, And so, I eventually went to the hospital, and they, after a day or so, they cleared me to go. And so that was the second kind of like event in this whole mix. So I go home the next day, and I'm just in my house, doing kind of like normal people stuff. After that, the trauma induced out of body experience and that light entity and the perception of time and the angelic orchestra and all this stuff, I had a different feeling in my body, right? Like we're like high vibrational, right? If I can even say that. It was very, people just try to describe it as like high frequency, high vibrational, and that kind of thing. But I felt that very visceral. And I was literally just grateful to be alive. Like, I mean, I was, the next part of this event is, or the sequence of events that I was just in my room, cleaning my room at night. Yeah, I'm just thinking, like, wow, it's such a miracle just to exist here and experience everything, like the wonder of just life, right? Like to even be here, if you consider like everything, right? Like all the cosmic processes that equal us being alive at this planet, at this time, being able to experience everything. I was just like grateful just to be alive, basically. And I'm just in my room. Cleaning my room, and it's at night, it's probably like 9 p.m. or so, and I just hear from out of nowhere in my mind, I guess, but I felt this voice in my whole body, and it said, come outside. So it was at that moment that I received like a download. People call it a download or a telepathic lock-on. So I try to describe this like the I don't know if this is actually what happened, But what I felt when I had this experience is that my consciousness was one with whatever was reaching out. Again, let me try to break this down. So when I heard the voice and I felt the voice, I saw these two entities, like my eyes were open, but there was like an overlay in my mind that I could see these two entities of a male and female, like typical Nordic entities with these like light blue suit kind of things. And again, it was a download. So that I had got this kind of, people call it a thought packet, right? It was just like somebody downloaded a book of information into my body simultaneously. And my mind is trying to like digest it like rapidly. But I'm excited because there's these feelings associated with it too. It's not just like information or whatever you want to call it. There were feelings and thoughts, and there was like a sense of connection to the entity. And so as soon as I heard that and felt it through my body, you know, I was ecstatic. And I ran outside. And I knew what was going to happen already, if that makes sense. I knew what was going on. And like, so that I ran outside and I get past where because if I look up, as soon as I went outside, there's like some trees there or whatever. So I'm running past that part and I look up, or even before I look up, I heard this almost like a bassy sound. It was like room, room. And well, you know, with that sound, I can feel those impulses in my body. And again, while it's just going on, I'm having something like a Kundalini experience, if I can say that. My body felt electrified and elated and giddy and that kind of thing. And I was feeling the presence of these entities, which felt like very warm and caring and all that kind of thing. And when I heard the very bassy kind of humming or, you know, reverberation, I looked up and I saw that kind of, if I can describe it, it was almost like a hexagon with rounded edges, but it was flattened more. So it almost looked like a disc, but it was more like a hexagon, and it was like a very dark metal. But it had a perfectly square white light fixture in the center on the bottom. And there were all these random color lights going around it, like red, blue, green, yellow, just bleeding around the edges of it. And I'm like, at this point, I'm freaking out because this object is maybe like 100 to 150 feet over me. This was not in the sky. Like, this was right above the trees. And it was like a freaking object, right? It was an unidentified flying object. Like, it was a physical metal thing. So that's what kind of separates this experience a bit from the other one, although it was connected to this whole thing. So I ran down these stairs to get into the driveway, and I'm just following this thing. This thing is just gliding across, making that low bass kind of humming. And instantaneously, as I'm looking at it, it disappears and then like automatically just instantly reappears maybe 1,000 feet away over this man-made lake over in the Hudson Valley. And I'm looking at it. So when it reappeared over there, I saw two other objects that looked identical, and they had the spinning light on it. And like at this point, I'm really questioning my reality because it's so in your face and it was so real that, again, just this was not like some kind of ball of light. It was an object. And I'm really at this point, I was thinking, did I just hit my head in this accident so hard that I'm hallucinating this? Because like what? Like I was like really trying to figure out like, how is this happening? Like, how is this even real? So I ran in my house and a few family members were there and I said, guys, you got to come outside. And they said, why? I said, they're here. And they said, who's here? I said, just come outside. So two of my family members came outside and they saw these objects, and that, you know, we're staring at these objects for a minute. And in my mind, I'm thinking like, holy crap, like the whole world knows this is going on for some reason. Like I didn't think that like, oh, after this, that, you know, nobody's going to know. I was thinking like, this is like, whatever these UFOs are, this is disclosure happening now. They're here. Right. So this happened, this went on for maybe 20 minutes or so. And then, you know, that the objects were just moving around in the sky and disappearing and then reappearing. And the way that the whole event ended was that one of them disappeared and then there was two of them left, and you know, I'm trying to get over here. And then, so the two of them, you know, that have light spinning and they're going towards each other like this, and the lights are spinning around and it looks like really kind of pretty cool actually. But they're, and right before they're about to come into each other, I'm thinking like, holy shit, they're going to crash. Right. And as soon as they made contact, I saw like a white light flash, and then they just vanished, and that was it. And it was like, okay, it was over, and the guy was quiet, and I'm just like, I was the whole night I was trying to absorb or take in the whole thing, and I like to kind of qualify certain things about some of these experiences, because that was the third and final, not, it wasn't final altogether, but of that three-part sequence, if I can call it like that, that changed, I guess you could say, the entire trajectory of my life. Because at that point, especially with the you can call it like the grand finale with that physical craft and the download and these kind of entities communicated that they're related to us somehow, and that they want the world to know that they're here. And I, of course, I felt obligated to somehow participate in that. I seemed like I was activated during these experiences, especially that final one. You know, I never questioned any of this for a while, as far as like, when all this occurred, like I was taking everything so literally, right? Like that these are some kind of maybe extraterrestrial entities, and they're visiting us, and they are related to us in a kind of like obvious way. But I, you know, over the years, I've come more, maybe like inquired about it a lot more in like a vichara contemplation, kind of sense, where I'm not being negative here, but I'm just stating the idea of like, okay, maybe there's different levels to it, right? My interpretation is not entirely accurate. Maybe they were trying to communicate ideas to me in a way that I could potentially understand based on my frameworks. Maybe they were completely manipulating the whole thing and just playing with my emotions and thoughts and that kind of thing. Like I've just put everything on the table. And I, at the end of the day, I have to say, I don't know which one it was. I don't know if everything is exactly what they communicated and what they said to me. I don't know if that was just my false impressions of whatever they were trying to communicate. I don't know if the entire thing was staged by them as a manipulation. I hate to say it, but I couldn't even know at this point if that was some kind of crazy CIA psyop that, you know what I mean? Like I highly doubt it, based on everything, given like how that whole thing could be orchestrated from the first experience to all the way to this one. But my mind is way more open now, in the sense that I have to keep it open to any possibility. And my ultimate gut sense is that it was genuine, and that these were some non-human intelligences that, for whatever reason, interacted with me, and everything, it felt genuine, right? Like, it all felt genuine. I didn't feel like there was any kind of deception involved. I felt maybe like, if anything, they were trying to communicate to me in a way that I can make sense of it. And so I can not like freak out more than I was. So that all of that, like really led me to being, it became a life mission for me to be involved with UFOs and UFO research. And also, it's at that point that I got involved with contact work, which is kind of like a whole other story.
Yeah. And I'd actually love to ask you a little bit more about that. And thank you for sharing all of your story. I really, really appreciate that. And we will dive into a little bit more with James Iandoli when we get right back from this commercial break.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice-monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
Unified, it's not like a conceptual way. Like, when you have the experience, that is a literal perception of time, space, on a completely different level. That almost feels like impossible while in your regular, normal waking state, because you wouldn't be able to process everything. Although when I was having the experience, it was super tranquil, and there was no doubt about any kind of thing about it. It was just obvious. And again, I have a sense or feeling that kind of the trauma-induced out-of-body experience, that whole thing created such a sharp or defined ripple in time-space that actually, in my speculation, is the event that instigated the event of the past and the future simultaneously. I think that event was so powerful that it somehow, again, instigated events that happened in the past. Like, again, as you said, in a retro-causal way. I can't explain that, and I can't explain how that happened, but I just have a feeling or a sense that is what made both the events occur in the past, and maybe even how the non-human intelligence noticed me for some reason, was because they have that same ability or ability to tap into that level of perception of time, space, and they may be able to notice other people who have at some point as well.
Yeah. Yeah. I really identify with that. I super short story. So I kind of had that feeling of like coming online or like being woken up or being activated in some way in 2021. But at the very beginning of 2020, like New Year's Eve going into 2020, I was standing in my apartment looking out the window watching fireworks with my brother, and there was like this flash. And suddenly I just like knew that someone very close to us in our family was sick. And I knew that it was in her chest. And I knew that, and it didn't make sense to me at the time going into 2020, but at the time, and I told all this to my brother, and I said, I know this sounds crazy, but she's sick. It's in her chest. And this next year is going to be really dangerous. And if she gets sick, like if she gets like the flu or cold or something, it could put her, like she could die. And 2 days later, we found out that that person had relatively advanced breast cancer. And then, of course, you know, we're going into COVID, and like suddenly the risk of her getting sick while she was going through like radiation and was immunocompromised and all of that was like very real. And at the time in my life, I had nothing. That's just one of many things, you know, that happened throughout my life. But like, I didn't have at the time like a way to frame that. But then once kind of things came online earlier, I had this really strong sense that the reason that that happened to me was so that when it was necessary for me to understand that there was like a different way to deal with time, that I would have known that, that I would at least have an experience that like grounded me in it, because it's so, we're so, even our language is like tied up in time. Like the way that we talk about time, it's really hard to even talk about time in a way that's not linear, because our language doesn't work that way. So yeah, I really identify with that. And it was really helpful for me when I was kind of coming into all of this to recognize that like, there's something that happens to people, this kind of like backwards and forwards thing that doesn't feel linear, it seems to be a major through line for a lot of different experiencer accounts.
Yeah. And actually something very interesting about language. You know, obviously in the arrival, there was that thing. And again, that film, The Arrival, I really liked how they portrayed that, because there was a lot of levels to that where whoever made that, I think they were tapping into something to have that, even the idea of it, right? And, you know, and speaking to language, there's a great book, I'm dropping the name of it right now, but it was by Greg Braden, and actually in the beginning of the book, he's describing how like language even affects your thinking.
Mm.
So, you know, language is important, and the words that we use are important, because it set the kind of framework for what you're allowed to think in a sense. So, you know, word can be powerful, and even just contemplating that is a useful exercise, I would say.
Absolutely. So with all of this and like kind of your entry into this world, you obviously never really had that kind of like initial nuts and bolts kind of approach. Like when you've had those kinds of experiences, you can't kind of turn that part off. So how do you think that you approach some of the more nuts and bolts and like disclosure oriented part of, because that's all part of this too. It's not like it's separate, like it's all part of the same thing. But how do you think you approach those things a little bit differently, given, like, in your research and in your work, given just the experiences that you've had?
Right. I do try to be pragmatic in the sense where I don't like to be on either extreme, in the sense where maybe we should say idealism, for one, I think is useful in different ways, just in the same way as materialism, right? They both have qualities that are useful and helpful for us to try to understand and make sense of reality, and even the UFO phenomena. So I don't like to, because even the idealism box is a box, right? In a sense where I can say, oh, well, everything is just immaterial, in a sense. Or on the other end of the spectrum, the materialism is, everything is just material and random. So a lot of times I've said that I love the UFO subject, and I didn't come to this idea for many years, the conceptualization at least, is that because the UFO or UAP represent a kind of like bridge between physics and metaphysics, right? Like idealism and materialism, because there you have what you can consider like a physical object that's in our consensus reality that we can kind of agree that it's there. There's, you know, you can get it on gun camera footage. It's not completely subjective. There's an objective quality to it. Yet it regularly and inherently seems to perform feats that are metaphysical. So you have the physical physics component to it and what we would consider metaphysics by the instantaneous, by just dematerialization, rematerialization, telepathy, transmedium by like, you know, and transmedium, I don't mean like, oh, wow, UFO is going up in the water. I mean, it's flying through a mountain. Entities are coming through your house and into your room and out, you know, potentially they can astral project your consciousness out of your body, right? And into a spaceship or you know, however you want to conceptually frame that. But you have here what seems to be technology and consciousness. So I don't think it's an either or question that I think that the UFO subject brings all that together. And that's why I think it's such an interesting issue. And it has the potential to draw scientists in, but then they have if they take the information seriously and somewhat at face value of what data is available, they have to consider the kind of metaphysical aspect to it. And by, I'm saying metaphysical to try to point to particular phenomena. I know if I say metaphysical or spiritual, you know, I'm using a word to describe something that nobody has the proper language to describe because we don't understand it. It's metaphysical, it's greater than physics as far as we so understand it right now. But I think that the UFO subject and the study of the UFO subject and anomalous experiences has the potential to show us where those points meet and how they really are the same thing. So, you know, at the intersection where you can have like a unified theory in a literal sense, not like just like some, wow, I have this really cool equation that UFOs can do this because of this XYZ reason. Like, yeah, I mean, that's the stepping stone, right? But I think that, well, you know, the study of UFOs and UAP, both in the materialistic sense, you know, and or the metaphysical sense is going to lead us to a greater understanding of reality altogether.
Yes. Well, I think that is the perfect place for us to leave things on this first part of the public portion of the show. For those of you who are leaving us, thank you so much for joining us today. James, why don't you tell people where they can find you and your work?
You can find me. You can just find me on Engaging the Phenomenon on YouTube, X or Twitter or whatever you call it these days, Instagram. Any, if you type in Engaging the Phenomenon anywhere, you're going to find my stuff. My links will be there. Or you can look up James Iandoli.
Amazing. Well, James and I are going to continue on for members for about another half an hour talking about James's work with contact work, which is really exciting. I've been wanting to talk to him about this for a while. So I hope you will join us over there. If you're not already a member, you can sign up at unknowncountry.com. And we'll see you guys next time. So obviously with your name, Engaging the Phenomenon, something that you're very interested in is engaging the phenomenon and not just in an intellectual or research capacity, although you do a lot of that as well. You do a lot of contact work. So can you, for people, I think a lot of people will be familiar with the idea in general, but can you just briefly explain kind of like what is contact work? How does, and how does it work?
Yeah. So contact work is, you know, you're intentionally going through processes to facilitate contact with non-human intelligence. And there's a whole number of ways you can do it. But ultimately, contact modalities, if I had to boil it down to an equation, it would be consciousness times or plus intention equals contact. So the, you know, your ability to navigate consciousness or utilize consciousness and intention together to facilitate a kind of, it could be a UFO encounter or an anomalous experience. Yeah, there's a whole number of ways that you can go about doing that. But, and, you know, in layman's terms, contact work is going through a process, whether it's an outlined one or kind of your own process of interacting with non-human intelligence.
Very cool. And before we continue, because I know we won't be able to get, we, this is just a short amount of time that we have to talk about this, but I know you've done a ton of work. And I just want everyone to know that if you check in the episode description, that I will have links to some of James's like other videos and resources and stuff about contact work if you have more questions, because there's like no way we'll cover it all here. Yeah. but yeah, no, this it's fantastic. I've been wanting to talk to you about this forever. So, so for people who are doing contact, can you, I think something that can be confusing for people, at least, you know, people that I've talked to who are kind of earlier in their exploration and they want to do contact work because maybe they haven't had a really kind of straightforward anomalous experience before, or they, you know, want to have one because they're just trying to kind of like confirm some things for themselves in terms of their trying to understand what this thing is. And so they go to contact work. And I think a lot of the times when I talk to people, it sounds like that contact work doesn't always go like the way that like it's surprising to them. That contact with non-human intelligences often doesn't happen like in the way that you and I are talking right now, obviously. And so can you talk a little bit about what that's like? Like how is, what's different about interacting with a non-human intelligence that might surprise people?
Yeah, I mean, by nature, you're not going to be able to, it's not like the movie, right? Or at least not like some movies, right? It's not, again, what you would expect is you, how could you expect that you're interacting with a non-human intelligence and they're going to interact with you somewhat on their terms, right? And I do want to put a small disclaimer here. I didn't years ago, but you could want to do contact work and have an encounter and not fully be prepared for what that entails. And what I mean is you can have like the best ultimate contact experience and you know, maybe you do some kind of meditation and you're intending to connect with the non-human intelligence and all of a sudden you find yourself in an astral projection face to face with an entity and they tell you something about the future or reality and like now you're like, holy crap, why am I going to work anymore? Because like, this is way more important. Like I should contribute to helping the entire world. What am I working this 9 to 5 for? Why am I with my spouse? You know, so there's a destabilizing component potentially to all. And it could just be like you're practicing Vipassana meditation. You have an awakening experience. It's not just contact of non-human intelligences that can set you off on that kind of path. But I do want to include a disclaimer here because you don't know what's going to happen. Generally speaking, with contact work, and I've worked with thousands of people over the years since 2009, when I found the CE5 work, again, thanks to Dr. Stephen Greer, I don't agree with a lot of his takes in some regard, but credit where it's due, I found contact work through his CE5 initiative, and I was actually very active and somewhat of a leader in that community back in 2009, 10, and somewhere in that period, and created some of the first CE5 social networks back then, and was heavily involved in field work and going out with people. So, when I say some of these things, it's my opinion, but it's a highly informed opinion. So I do want to qualify that in the sense where, I've done the work, I've spoken with thousands of witnesses and experiences, and it could be everything from an orb experience to a lucid dream to a crazy synchronicity that occurs in like your waking life to an apparent UFO encounter in broad daylight or at night time. You don't know how it's going to happen, and you're not really in control of it in the sense of maybe your higher self is at some level, if I want to speculate on that level, but I would say don't even have expectations. Like, you don't want to limit what can occur because of, you're thinking it has to happen a certain way, because there could also be things going on that you don't even realize because you're looking for a metal disc in the sky and like Nordic or gray beans come out of it and tell you, hey, I'm here, when like Lolo Hondo, you can have worms in your house, right? Which is very common for many experiences. So I would say, don't have any expectations going into it. I mean, we're naturally going to have a little bit, right? Like, but my advice would be to just be open to what could occur and just be genuine in your approach.
What do you find to be the most valuable about contact work? Like, what is it about it that causes you to pursue it in kind of an ongoing way?
Okay, that's a great question. that's in part, I'm in the early process of writing a book, and that actually has a lot to do with that. And for me, I mean, initially you're like, holy crap, there's this other intelligence that's real, right? Like initially that's like, wow, man, it's true. We're not alone. So that is a powerful takeaway that even that will transform your perspective of like reality and the universe and maybe like caring about each other and like being better, right? There's other intelligence out there who seemingly made it, right? We can too. So there's like an initial kind of paradigm shift in that. But, more as I've gone down and had interactions and engaged the phenomenon directly rather than like listening to narratives that are in the media and what have you, you can find out for yourself. But one of the major takeaways from contact work that I've had in more recent years, and maybe I had it in the beginning and I didn't even realize it, but I'm much more conscious of it now, and it got me things like reading like the holographic universe and all these like more deep dive, like the conscious self-aware universe and stuff, is that whether it's the interaction itself or the modus operandi and how contact occurs in the first place, is that it's showing you in a visceral and direct way about the nature of reality. In a literal way. It's not like conceptual, like you're watching a movie and like, wow, I get how that happens. Like, no, you experience it firsthand. And maybe you can't fully understand it right away, but even over time, as you unpack those experiences and even downloads, it, it, it's unraveling reality in a sense, where like it's showing you deeper truths, I could say, or deeper themes about reality and yourself through that process of engaging the phenomenon, right? You're, in a sense, you're not just engaging the phenomenon, you're engaging reality, and with that, you're engaging yourself.
That's such a great point. I find something that's always so fascinating about doing this work, you know, being kind of pursuing the question of non-human intelligence, is that it seems to always bring us back to ourselves, right? Like we're trying to understand what this other thing is, and it ends up kind of throwing this mirror up in front of us and showing us who we are. Kind of along those lines, it seems, I don't know, I don't want to put words in your mouth because this is not my area of expertise at all, but it does seem like, you know, people do have encounters that are frightening, or, you know, or can feel really negative in a way. Are there things that people can do to kind of protect themselves against that, or to get themselves ready? Like are negative contact experiences something you can avoid? Should you even try to avoid them? Like how should people wrap their minds around that part of it?
Right. That's an important question. And there are different ways to approach it for different people. I mean, my first advice would be like, you got to have your mental trip together before you engage in this kind of work, in my opinion. I mean, if, you know, don't go out and do contact work if you just broke up with your girlfriend or spouse or something. Like, you want to be in a grounded, and you want to be in a kind of good space, not where you're like worrying about all these kind of things. It can sound like a little bit new agey, but like, yeah, like protection stuff, like you can most certainly do that kind of thing. And different things are going to work for different people. Like protection could be just like before you engage in contact work for maybe 5 or 10 minutes, you can do a meditation, a visualization of like white protective light around you. Set the intention that you only want to interact with entities that are peaceful, right? And that is actually something that's baked into CE5, right? The whole intention to interact with peaceful non-human intelligence, although they do it in a little bit more of a dogmatic way, similar to Mission Rama, who also did similar work. But, I mean, your intention is important. There is, however, a nuanced and kind of advanced Zen approach to it as well, which, you know, people might not relate to it. Some people will relate to it automatically, and some people are going to disregard it because that's not their way of doing it. But if you have the attitude where you have such conviction that there's no question in your mind that the right experience is going to come to you, that is the most advanced way of going about it. But not if you have like a one single drop of doubt, it's going to kind of tarnish that a little bit. So it kind of depends on your attitude. I joke around that I'm like the kind of kid who would take a paper clip and put it into an electrical socket. That's just my attitude, right? And like, I just want to see what's going to happen, right? But that kind of thing, I mean, you want to go into it with a positive attitude. You know, but there's also something to be said. It's like, if you have doubts and concern about it, you want to work through that before you start doing the work. And I don't discount negative experiences at all by any means. I mean, just, you know, there's arguments that people are saying, oh, well, all the media is trying to give you this threat narrative. But on the other side, there's another group who I'm not even going to name who are saying, oh, well, they're all manipulating you and they're all negative entities and they're making you think they have positive entities. And I'm like, dude, you're just invalidating your own perspective by forcing your perspective on everybody else. So don't do that. Let people make up their own mind about their own experiences and encounters. Don't let anybody ever try to taint your experience with their opinion. They didn't experience it, you did. But again, if you have a very lighthearted and innocent approach to the work, you're going to get far, in my opinion, especially if you're disciplined and consistent.
That's such great advice. And I wonder how this strikes you. Like, I don't personally do much like contact work per se. I'm newer to this, and my world has been shaken enough in the last 3 years. I think that at some point I'll feel ready for that, but I'm not quite there. But I will say that, like, I have had plenty of anomalous experiences in doing this work, and some of them have been scary. But in some ways, like, the scary ones have also been, like, instructive in their own way. And, like, if you bring that attitude to it, like, understanding that we have, like, we don't really know what we're dealing with. Like, it's really hard for us to conceive of what an advanced non-human intelligence is like, even. And, you know, I think about things like, you know, people who might, you know, there's like an endangered elephant, you know, and it's got something wrong with it. And, you know, some doctors and vets are going to go out there and they're going to, you know, trank dart this thing, and they're going to fix it or give it the medicine it needs or whatever, and then let it go. Like, that's all for the benefit of the elephant, but that's probably not how the elephant experienced that. And it was probably, like, really horrifying. It was, you know, all of these, something like that actually, I think, has a lot in common with many types of experiences. And so, like, I mean, have you had that where, like, you feel like some kind of your attitude that you bring to even some of the more disconcerting parts of this can kind of, like, reframe things for you and make it valuable in the end?
Yeah, it absolutely can. And at the same time that I do have that, I also am open to possibility. And hey, if somebody has evidence that say these entities have these intentions, then we have to be concerned about it. Show me it, because otherwise I can only go based off what I know, and what I know is my own experience. And, you know, I'm not going to have somebody put forward some kind of narrative and change what I experienced firsthand, you know, because that doesn't make any sense. So I am open. I'll listen for sure. I'll listen to what people have to say, and I'll listen to their concerns and their opinion, and even other people who have experienced different things. And I do want to say that I don't think everybody is experiencing the same thing. I think that there are different phenomena that are occurring, and we're trying to make sense of it. And sometimes it gets lumped into one category, and it doesn't belong in one category. And, you know, but the only way that we're going to get through that aspect of it all is transparency, I think, right? Like, that's why I am supportive of transparency efforts, because it's going to take us working together to put our minds together to have a better understanding of it. As far as, you know, we have like at least 80, 90 years of UFO research. We have another like 2000 years of like religious studies and experiences to throw into that. And now we have like AI, and we have like all these engaged researchers. We have academics getting involved. We have people in national security position getting involved. I think it's going to be a lot. It's going to be a lot more messy before it gets any clearer, right? Like, we're still discovering the mess. Like, we're still stubbing our toes on the sand on the floor. We're, you know, we haven't seen the entire kind of, as I got from the, from Gurdjieff, the terror of the situation, right? Like, we haven't even stumbled upon the true reality of it all. We're just like the kind of elephant, right? Like, one person touches the trunk and one person touches the leg and the body of it. And we're saying this and that and this. We don't even have the full picture yet, so it's gonna take that. So I'm patient in the sense where I know that this is gonna take a while, but it does require an open mind and patience. But you know, most importantly in all that, you have to be true to yourself and your own experiences as well.
Yes, absolutely. So for people who want to get into contact work or just want to learn more about it, obviously we'll have some of your resources linked up in the episode description. Where do you recommend that people start?
That's a great question. start wherever you're most comfortable, right? However, I would recommend if people want to test, but it's also kind of my personality. Is like I get very into things, but consistency I think is important. So you can find, I made a few videos with outlining how to do some contact work. Historically, you have the C5 protocols that Dr. Stephen Greer has put out there. Those are valid. You can take those protocols and not swallow his ideology, right? You can just listen to his basic protocols of like, okay, I'm going to do a 15 to 20 minute meditation and get in a tranquil state. Then I'm going to attempt to do a remote viewing procedure or astral projection procedure after I've already reached a tranquil state and intend to interact with peaceful non-human intelligence and have an encounter. And you can do a visual sequence to facilitate that or to empower it. And you can rinse and repeat that process over and over and or modify it to your own inclination. That's a very basic way. But I would say, the more effort you put in or the more work you put in, the greater chance that you're going to get a result. Some people are just going to be naturals, right? Some people, for me, I had the experience, right? If you've had an encounter already, that sense, that feeling, the sensation that you had during the encounter, I always come back to those and use that as like starting point of how to have an encounter, because I've experienced an encounter. So if you bring that quality to the practice, you're likely going to be more effective as well.
So cool. Well, it's been absolutely wonderful talking with you about all of this. When I am ready to do contact work, you're going to be the first person I'm going to be hitting up for advice. But I love hearing about it. And I really enjoy all the work that you've done on it. Your podcast is one of my absolute favorites. And you've done some incredible interviews recently, by the way. I binged all of them on a car ride recently with, Jim Semivan and Peter Lavenda and Keith Thompson. Those were all fantastic. So thank you so much for joining me today, James. This has been so much fun. And I hope I run into you again soon. I miss you. I haven't seen you in a long time.
Yeah, I'm sure we will. I hope so too. And thank you so much for having me on. And I look forward to talking to you again soon and on and off the air.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Anne Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.